Mainstream economics, through a whole series of accidental failures, has resulted in a theory of economics which is the exact opposite of what they think they're trying to prove, which is about the essential role of the market in enabling a capitalist economy to coordinate without needing an external intelligence to drive it, either central planning on one hand or feudalism on the other. In fact, they've ended up building a model in which the only way it can work is if each last one of us has the intelligence of God. And they still think that's actually addressing what Adam Smith was talking about two centuries ago, which is completely wrong. So in the meantime, they've stuck on this ossified idea about an equilibrium approach to the economy, enabling coordination, and everything has to be in equilibrium. We now know that most interesting systems are far from equilibrium, and those techniques have been developed in the physical sciences, the genuine sciences. I'm trying to bring them across to economics. So partly debunking economics is a demolition job, saying these are all the times in which either critics of the mainstream have proven it to be wrong, or the mainstreamers themselves have proven it to be wrong, but fudge the answer. And I describe what neoclassical economists do as not mathematics, but mythematics. My main claim to fame is writing a book called Debunking Economics, another one called Can We Avoid Another Financial Crisis? And both of them I apply the thought of non-mainstream economists like Hyman Minsky, Schumpeter, and so on, in what are fundamentally complex systems models of the economy. And using that, I basically predicted not just the Great Recession, but the Great Moderation that preceded it in a paper I wrote back in 1992. So what I've been doing since then is trying to reform economics, and I'm going to do it freelance with the help of the public through Patreon from now on. If I go back to when I was a school student, which is 1970, I'm talking more than, you know, coming up to five decades ago, the economics textbooks that I used then were more advanced than are used in second-year economics today. Far more advanced than Mankiw, for example. So I learned indifference curves. I learned the Hicks model of the trade cycle in year 11 at school, one year before them, doing the high school certificate. And I seriously believe the whole picture of an equilibrating market leading to effectively a system where you don't need any external control. The fundamental thing about neoclassical economics is to say there's no need for a government, there's no need for us to behave collectively, we can all behave as individuals and reach a social nirvana. And I remember writing a first year paper where I said the world would be better off without trade unions and government, et cetera, et cetera. Then what I realized from that is that what an education in economics does is make you into a zealot. Okay? It isn't just teaching you how to analyze a system in some dispassionate sense. In a similar way to Ptolemaic astronomy made you a zealot about the universe having Earth at the center because that's where God wanted it, economics makes you believe that the ideal system is disaggregated markets and your role is to get rid of all the elements of the real world that are different to the textbook. Now, that gives you effectively the behavior, even you think you've justified it. Ironically, all the mathematical work that's been done, including by neoclassicals, is that doesn't work. But because they wanted it to work so much, they've brought in those mathematical components to jump over problems. And what you've got is a form of cult. And of course, the most dangerous cult is a cult that doesn't realize it is one. And that is fundamentally what I see in neoclassical economists as being. Very nice people, but to use a little analogy I actually used in the preface to the second edition of the book, as a school kid, we were had a great school teacher who let us have open discussions and just we'd share the meetings, he'd sit at the back and say nothing. And one day we were discussing some politician and somebody in the class, we're all criticising this guy, and somebody popped up and said, well, at least he's sincere. And everybody in the class said, yeah, we all agreed with that, and nodding our heads sagely. And this teacher piped up from the back of the room and said, don't overrate sincerity. The most dangerous person you'll meet in the world is a person who's sincerely chasing you down the road trying to cut your head off. And in a fundamental way, that's what I see neoclassical economists as being. They have a vision of a perfect world. They're going to lead us there. It's for our own benefit. We're terribly sorry that it's screwed up. No, we're not. We don't believe it has. It's all your fault. We're going to continue reforming it. So that means you are almost immune to realizing you've made mathematical errors, for a start, realizing you've made not simplifying assumptions, but fantastical assumptions, and also immune to experiencing events that you knew couldn't happen, and then you continue on as though nothing happened after they did. The one person in an intellectual history who I thought brought together all the strengths and the weaknesses of capitalism in an analysis of it was Hyman Minsky. And what he argued was that capitalism, well, what he argued was economics had to answer an important question, and that question was, can it happen again, with it being a Great Depression? And when he wrote in 1982, if it can happen, why hasn't it happened between 1945 and 1982? And that, to me, is the fundamental question economics has to answer. And I combined the mathematics that I knew from complex systems and so on to build a model of that. And also, I'm trying to incorporate the wisdom from Schumpeter, from Marx, the good parts of Marx. There are good parts of Marx. There are certainly bad parts too. Bring those all together into one theory. So I would generally be described as a Minskyan economist. And I'm using very similar foundations to Minsky, as I'm aware from talking to his family. But that means that I'm using an approach to mathematics that students themselves aren't equipped for. If they do an economics degree, they don't learn the mathematics of complex systems. And I'm using techniques I learned from the computer industry, because I spent 15 years working as a computer software evaluator. With the support of INET back in 2011, I think, or 2010, can't quite remember, the second round of funding, I put forward a proposal for funding the development of a system dynamics program designed specifically to handle monetary dynamics. So there are, system dynamics is an approach which eliminates ceteris paribus. Okay? You have a system where X causes Y causes change in Z causes Q causes X, and you get a causal loop. And that's that approach, which is non-ceteris paribus, was designed back in the 1950s and 60s by a management consultant and a designer of the weapon systems in the Second World War, Jay Forrester. And that became heavily, rapidly adopted in engineering. So programs like MATLAB, which people use that to design 787s, MATLAB, VisSim, Modelica, a whole range of software packages like that. Economists don't even know they exist. But I thought that was a fabulous foundation. And what they use is a flow chart to build equations. So the flow chart gives you that causal structure. But that flow chart approach is very cumbersome and clumsy for financial flows. Because for financial flows, you have to actually record each flow four times to actually record it properly. So I came up with the idea of building using double entry bookkeeping, which is what the accountants, the first real GUI graphical user interface was double entry bookkeeping. So you use that to design the financial equations in a flowchart system, and that's what Minsky does. One of the difficulties of Minsky, and this actually, like Tom Ferguson and I had this conversation over breakfast one day, he said, why is Minsky so hard to use? Part of my answer was, if he only gave me half the amount of money I asked to develop it, and I've still only doubled that half, so I've got to as far as I wanted to get in the very first version. But it's also, economists are unfamiliar with the technology. So they, when they see this diagram with wires connecting things to other objects and so on, it's just an unfamiliar interface. It doesn't look like a spreadsheet. It doesn't look like Excel. It doesn't look like eViews, all the stuff they know. So it's been very slowly adopted by people around the world, but now a number of students have really leapt into it. So the most remarkable is one of my PhD students now, a guy called Pedro Pratas. And Pedro is doing a master's degree in Portugal, and he decided to build a Minsky model using the Minsky software of the Portuguese economy. And I knew that wasn't possible. Unfortunately, he didn't, so he did it. And he built this, it looks like a horrible mess because the interface is not designed for that, the complexity of equations you can design right now. The definitions all involve lines connecting to other pluses and minuses and multipliers and divides and so on. And because there's so many definitions in defining a five-sectoral view of the economy, which is what he's done, it's a mess. You can't even look at it. I don't know how he designed it. I have incredible respect for this guy for being able to push the tool that far. But he developed a model in his master's thesis which is more accurate than any other model of Portugal, including the ones by the Central Bank and the Treasury. So people are starting to run with it, but it's still the very, very early days, and I still need to develop a software substantially to make it actually properly support the ambition I have, which is I want it to be something which actually generates a virtual model of economies that politicians can be have explained to them, accept, and then be told, okay, before you try this little idea of yours out on the real world, try it out in the model and see what happens. Economic theory has, most people who aren't economists believe economists are experts on money. And what they don't realise is, again, one of these little historical accidents. Mainstream economics began fundamentally with Wohlrausch's model back in the 1870s, where he was trying to model market trade reaching equilibrium without any external control. And his vision of that was the Paris Bourse, where there were individual commodities which were traded with an auctioneer who would make sure demand equals supply before trades took place in that individual market. And so he scaled it to say, could you have a room where all markets did that at once and no trade occurred in any market until all markets were in equilibrium? Could we get to that point? And mathematically, of course, they can't, but that doesn't stop economists from using that as their foundation. But as some of your simplifying assumptions, you assume no money, no banks, and no debt. Now, that got ossified into economic theory. And at the same time, they wanted to say nominal factors in inflation, prices, absolute prices, only affect the price ratios, the price level. They don't affect actual economy. So they wanted to have the monetary system having no impact upon the real. And that became what they call money neutrality. So all this stuff becomes embedded in mainstream education. And if you survive in education or an inculcation in mainstream economics, you think that money makes no difference. Well, in the real world, what banks do is create money. And if they create money, they don't create it so it sits in a bank vault and you can pay interest back to the bank. They create them so you can spend it. So that creation of money by banks creates spending power. It has a definite impact upon the economy. And that completely changes the nature of macroeconomics once you recognize that. Schumpeter recognized it back in the 1920s. Irving Fisher realized it in the 1930s. Pigou realized it in the late 1920s. So it was something that was sitting there. But the mainstream wants to keep the models nice and neat and tidy, and money makes it all very messy from their point of view. They continue assuming it doesn't matter. I'm saying if you're modeling an economy that doesn't have money, you're not modeling capitalism. So we need a framework that lets us do that, and Minsky is specifically designed to do that. So my original work in economics was on Marx's theory of value, deriving it from his dialectical philosophy. And part of that dialectical philosophy always has a foreground and a background. So if you, that gives me a foundation that lets me integrate the two. So the vision I have of that is that this is Hegel and Marx is together, is the argument that any unity is embedded in a society. Society will focus upon one aspect of that unity, making it the foreground. But the unity can't exist without the rest of its elements, which are pushed into the background, and therefore you sort of stretch the unity, and there's a tension between the foreground and the background. And that gives you a basis to say there'll be transformation over time. But it also means I could talk about moral philosophy at one extreme and self-interest at the other. Now, when you see that there's a unity there, you've got to have a tension between the two. And you can't get rid of one and just focus on the other. But there's this tendency in humanity to do that. And if you look at our religious theories, that ends up with the same extreme, one extreme or the other. The only religions that don't do that are things like Buddhism, which talk about yin and yang, and you know, you've got to think the balance right between one extreme and another. We always, as a species, seem to fall for an extreme. So we need a philosophy that lets us avoid that. And Smith didn't, even though he provided both moral philosophy on one hand and self-interest on the other, he didn't provide a philosophy that integrated the two, so economics ran off on one extreme. If it took money to write E equals MC squared, we would never have got the money to write it. So there's a real dilemma there, and I don't know how Einet copes with that over time, but I think the best thing you have done is basically you've thrown large amounts of money at the young kids and said, run with it. And I think they're doing a fabulous job, and so my real hope comes out of the YSR initiative, because that energy of youth and the desire for change, you've harnessed that and you've fueled it, and that's probably the best thing you can do. But I also wouldn't mind some extra money being thrown at Minsky.